Hi, welcome to SQL Bits. My name's Anna, and I'm going to be talking to you about Scala for Big Data, the big picture. I'm a senior advancing analytics consultant. I'm specialised in data engineering and cloud, and I've got over 14 years' experience working in software and data engineering, most recently working with Scala, Kafka, and various cloud tech. I've got a Bachelor of Science in Multimedia Computing and Business and HND in Visual Communications. So what makes me tick? I'm passionate about data and strive to bring the two worlds of software development and data science to closer together. I help to organize and run local code clubs and organize and volunteer at local events. Other areas of interest include UX and agile methodologies. One meetup in particular that I volunteer at is Subject Data in Bristol. We also have meetups in Cardiff and Swindon. Okay, so what are we going to do? We are going to do a bit of theory. So we're going to do a Scala overview. We're going to look at some functional programming, do some practical XML transformation into JSON, and then we're going to write the JSON data to Data Lake Gen 2, and then refine our data using Azure Databricks. So we're going to have a real world problem. This has taken out my day job. It is basically third-party API with some old-school XML responses that needed transforming into JSON and then writing to an event queue and stored in a data lake. At the bottom there is a link to the GitHub repo that will have all the code that I demoed today. So essentially, we'll be going from an Azure function into a data lake into Databricks. So what is Scala? Scala is object-oriented and functional programming paradigms all wrapped into one. What is it used for? A lot of things, ranging from machine learning to web apps. The name Scala stands for scalable language. The language is so named because it was designed to grow with the demands of its users. As mentioned, Scala incorporates object orientation and functional programming paradigms. Normally, these are very separate, but with Scala, it wraps them all together. Or both of them together. So it's very unusual in what it does, but it is very good for if you want to start learning functional programming, especially if you're coming from an object-oriented background. So is Scala the ultimate teaching language? Well, if we start looking at Python here, it's a procedural programming language. It's got a REPL, and then on the other side, we've got Java, we've got compilation, static types, data structures, design patterns, C style. And at the bottom there, functional programming, JavaScript, and object orientation there sitting across Java and Python. But what if you want to combine all of these together? Well, Scala does this nicely, so it's a good place to start, like I said, if you want to start learning functional programming. So who uses Scala? We've got some quite big names here. We've got Netflix, Twitter, Airbnb, Sony, Foursquare, and my absolute favorite, Disney. Software written in Scala. So we've got the common ones that you may know here would be Databricks, Spark, Kafka, but then we've also got Play and Akka, which are very popular within Scala developers and functional programmers. Scala and big, no wait, fast data. Scala has taken over the world of fast data. This is a quote that I got online that I absolutely love. It's a little bit dramatic, but it really illustrates it nicely. So, in this diagram here, we've got an IoT hub, an event hub, Kafka on one side, so that's our data sources. And then on the other side, we've got Power BI, databases, data lake store, and Azure storage blobs on the other side. So, in the middle there, we've got Spark streaming on HD Insight. Spark, once again, being written in Scala with Scala under the hood. So, what we're doing with Spark here is actually using it for our streaming, our big data, for our transformations. So it's basically utilizing the power of Scala using Spark. But still, why bother? I know a lot of you will be very passionate about Python, about R. Why would you use Scala? Scala is a transferable and portable skill set that is also competitive. So it's a useful skill to have. Scala is multi-purpose, meaning you can use it for anything from a simple web app to machine learning. It has a solid community behind it. It is type safe, and it gives you the opportunity to learn functional programming. So, type safety. What is type safety? Type safety means that a compiler will validate types while compiling and throw an error if you try and assign the wrong type to a variable. What does this mean? Type safety basically means you can't turn a cat into a dog. So, if you've got a some text, you can't then turn it into a number. Like you can with other languages such as Python, you can just transform it. You can just say, this is now a number. With type safety, if you say it's going to be a string, so you see it's going to be text, that is what it is, unless you do specific functions over the top, transformations, parsing, to actually turn that specifically into a number. So there we go. Functional programming. So you can't talk about Scala without talking about functional programming, but it's not too scary. What we've got here are some of the core concepts of functional programming. So mutability, closure, first class functions, maintainability, modularity, referential transparency. And functional programmers absolutely love category theory. They can talk about it for hours. We're not going to go into all of these, but what we will look at is a monad. So, what is a monad? Monads, if you were to Google them, would come back with lots of convoluted answers as to what it is, really long-winded. In essence, a monad is a sequence of events with a get-out-of-jail card. So if you've got your code here, which would be step one, step two, step three, in any of these steps, you've got a get-out-of-jail card, so you can break out of the sequence at any time without having, say, for example, to use a big try catch around the statement, you've got your monad there that will handle it, and you'll have happy paths and sad paths for your code. So back to Spark and Databricks, once again written in Scala under the hood. What exactly are they, if anyone hasn't actually used them before? So Apache Spark. So we're coming back to this diagram again, which you saw before. We've got the IoT hub, event hub, Kafka, so that's all our sources, and then all our destinations, so databases, Power BI dashboards, data lake store. And once again, Spark just sits in the middle, and it enables you to do your streaming, to do your transformations. It is a tool set there that you can work with. And Spark also plugs into lots of other common tools within the data realm. So we've got like MySQL, Kafka, Hadoop, Cassandra, MongoDB. So already those integrations are there and you're ready for you to work with. Databricks. Databricks is based on Apache Spark. So Spark came first and then Databricks was created. So it has a Spark engine essentially under the hood. It was founded to provide an alternative to MapReduce systems and provide just-in-time cloud-based platforms for big data processing. Databricks was created for data scientists, engineers, and analysts to help use it integrate the field of data science, engineering, and businesses behind them across the machine learning lifecycle. So illustrated here, we've got our data science, data engineering on one side, line of business, and many others on the other side, our destinations again, so Power BI, data warehousing, streaming, machine learning, and Azure Databricks, Spark under the hood, in the middle, doing our data transformation, streaming our data. So, back to Scala. So, basics of Scala. So, first things first, we're going to look at some of the basics, some tools that you may use if you're working with Scala, some very useful tools. So we're going to start with case classes, options, then pattern matching, map and flat map, reduce and filter, and then four comprehensions. So starting with case classes. So case classes are great for modeling immutable data and act like blueprints. So the same as if you're building a house and you've got all the different pieces that you know how you want to fit together and you're drawing that picture. For modeling data, you can work with case classes in Scala and that does that with your data for you. Okay, so what we have here is an instance of Databricks in Microsoft Azure, and I've opened myself up, created myself a notebook, I've named it Case Classes, and we are going to write some really basic Scala just to create ourselves a case class. So, we can literally, if I'm going to type properly, in case class employee, and then what do we want for our employee? Well, we want a first name and a last name. I'm going to say our first name It's going to be a string, there's type safety again. And then our last name. And that's going to be a string as well. So that's us defining a case class. So we're just running our command here. Sorry, missed the P out there. Run it again. Okay, so it tells us it's defined the class of employee. So it's created that object for us, that case class employee. So now we can start actually doing some stuff with it. So I'm going to define myself a variable. I'm going to say, right, let's create an instance of employee. And so the first name is Ada, second name of Love. Right, so I'm saying here's an instance of my employee, Ada Lovelace, and we get returned employee equals instance of employee, Ada Lovelace. So now we've got our instance of our employee, what can we do with it? Well, case classes come with some really useful tools out of the box, including hashcode. So what's this? What is it? What do we do with it? The hash code is basically a hash of every value that you've got within your case class. So it's a hash of Ada and Lovelace. This is really useful when you're comparing current data and historic data to check for changes. So really, really useful tool out of the box that you get with case classes. What do you do if you want to actually then make a copy of this data? Well, because we're working with immutability, which means you can't change the object that you're working with. What we can do with case classes is we can do a copy of that object to create a new instance. So it's exactly the same as for Ada Lovelace, we've just made ourselves a copy of it. What do we do if we want to actually change some of the values? Well, very similar to what we did before. So I'll just do a quick copy and paste. Then we'll do M3. We want to do a copy, but we want to change a value. How do we do that? You can just do first name equals, first name equals say Dave, run that. So it returns as a new instance of the employee object, but this time it's changed that original name of Ada to Dave because we told it to. So just to clarify, if we try to do employee2.firstname and change the value this way to actually mutate that original object, we will get an error. And that's exactly what we want because this is immutable. We don't want to mutate the data. We want to make copies out of it every time and change the data in the copy. So how does this compare to Python? So if I just paste in some Python code here. So we've got, we're just setting up an instance of variable employee there. We're going to say, right, my employee is true. And then actually now I'm going to change the type completely and say, actually, it's going to be Dave. And in Python, it will allow you to do it. So if we run this code here. So it returns the value Dave, it doesn't have an issue, whereas in Scala, because of our type safety, it doesn't allow us to do this. So it's basically less errors and it works more nicely when working with your data in this way. Okay, so now we're going to look at options. So options handle empty values without error. What does that mean? Well, let's rewind a little bit. The normal mistake I call it my billion-dollar mistake. It was the invention of the null reference in 1965, Tony Hall. So being able to have nulls in programming languages has caused issues over the years, and it has been recognised that, in the words of Tony Hall here, it being a billion-dollar mistake. Functional programmers don't believe in nulls. They have ways around it, and one of them, for instance, in Scala, is working with options. So how does Scala handle nulls? So with an option, you're going to return either sum equal to something or none, which means nothing, which is essentially replacing those null values that you would normally work with. Okay, so we're in a notebook again within Databricks within Microsoft Azure, looking at options. So what we've got here is what I've already prepared. We've got val A is an option, it's going to be a type of string, and then we're saying val A is going to be a sum value. And then B is an option again, exactly the same, but we're deliberately then saying this is actually going to return a none. So those again are those different types that you can get with options. So what are we going to do now? We are going to look at some of the stuff you get out of the box when working with options. So if I did A is empty, that gives us a boolean of false. What does that mean? It means we're saying, is it empty? Is there actually a value in there? And it's saying, well, I've got a sum, so it's got a value, right? So it's given us a return type of false. What if we say B is empty? What do we get then? Well, that comes back as a true, because as we know, B has a value of none, which is essentially an empty value, similar to a null. Okay, so what I've copied and pasted here is a function I created called showMatch. And what this is demonstrating is how we can actually then work with the sum and the none return types of option. So we'll just run that command, and then we want to actually use an instance of showMatch. So if we say showMatch, and then say put B in there, because they're the variables you set up earlier here, and run the cell. We know B doesn't have a value in there, it is a none. So it's finding that case of none and returning a question mark, because that's what we've told it to do in this match statement within Scala. So there is a simpler way of doing that. We can literally do B get or else, and run that cell, and we get the exact same result. So this is an example of working with a match statement in Scala, which are really popular, but then you've also got this functionality out of the box that you can work with a get or else. Okay, so now we're going to move on to map and flat map. So starting with map, what is a map? Map essentially opens a box of data and transforms it accordingly. What does that mean? The best way to demonstrate this is initially just show you the code and how it works. So here we have a notebook again in Microsoft Azure in Databricks. And what we've got is we've set out a variable that has a list of 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5. And when we run that, it returns us a list of 1, 2, 3, 4, and 5 as expected. So what have we got here in this next command? So what we're doing is we're saying A, our variable here, dot map. And then we're saying X equals to list X dash zero. What is that doing? Well, it's taking our list here, and for every item, which is X, it's gonna return a list of the item value and then appending a zero. So our result is what we see here. We've got a list of lists. So we've got a list of list 1, 0, list of 2, 0, and so on and so forth. So essentially that's what our map has done. It's taken the data and it's done some transformation on it. It's actually put a list around that each item and appended a zero. So If it's still a little bit unclear on what map is doing and what we can use it for, we've got map explained with emojis. So what we've got here is a map with a cow, a potato, a chicken, and some corn, and then we're going to cook it. And our result, if we're working with a map, would be a burger, some chips, a chicken leg, and some popcorn. So flat map. What is flat map? So it opens a box of data, transforms it, and flattens it accordingly. So what do we mean by that? What is it doing? So a flat map is essentially, following on from what we were doing before, if we do exactly the same functionality, a flat map is going to flatten the data. So run the cell again. Take its time. But it's taking that list of lists. It's taking the list, and whereas before it would give you a list of lists, a flat map isn't going to do that. In a second, we'll be able to see what it actually returns. Oh dear. Let's run that command there, sorry. Demo God's not being kind, there we go. So what it returns is essentially a list of all the values you would have had in all of those lists that we've got here, but it's been flattened. So it's got rid of all of those inner lists and just given us 10, 20, 30, 40, whereas before we had a list of 10, a list of 20. Explained again in emojis. Or sorry, with some more imagery, sorry. When you forget to use flat map, essentially, this is a really funny illustration where you've got two cats in a box, but the cat is in a box in the box. So when you forget to use flat map properly, like we had when we had lists in lists, here we've got the cat in the box in the box. So reduce and filter. So summing everything up and only getting data that you actually need. So here, once again, we've got a notebook in Azure, Microsoft Azure Databricks. What we're initially doing is we're setting up our test data again. So we've got a list and we're saying we've got a range of 1 to 10, which returns us 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, and 9. And then we want to filter that. And what we're doing here is we're going to say everything that's divisible by 2, that's what I want to filter by. So I only want values that are divisible by 2. And when we run it, we get a list of 2, 4, 6, and 8, because obviously they're divisible by 2. But that's filter. But moving on to actually working with reducing, we're going to set up some more test data. So we've got a sequence here, 3.5, 5, and 1.5. And what we're doing with reduce here is we're taking all of those values out of that sequence, applying a reduce, and what that does is actually sums them all up. So as you can see here, it returns a sum of 10. And essentially that is what reduce is doing for you in this instance. So right, once again, this time, yes, explaining in emojis. So filter and reduce explained with emojis. So we've got filter here, which would be a burger, some chips, some chicken, some popcorn. Is vegetarian would return the chips and the popcorn. And if we're working with a reduce, we've got a burger, some chips, chicken, and some popcorn, and we're going to eat it, and it produces poop. Right, four comprehensions. So this is the last of our basics of Scala demos. We're going to look at a basic four comprehension, which is essentially a monad. Okay, so once again, a notebook in Microsoft Azure and Databricks, where we're going to demo a four comprehension. So this is just importing all of the namespaces that we need. We're setting up an instance of our case class again, our employee case class. We're saying this is the XML that we're going to be parsing in. And this is just some boilerplate functionality that I've created to be able to transfer the XML. And like I said, this code will be available in the GitHub repo, the link that I showed you before, which will also be available at the end. So what we are interested in essentially is this transform XML. And what this is doing is it's using a fork extension, a monad, to actually pass through the payload, the XML, and then try and find the different elements, the first name, last name, and the age. And then it will return an instance of employee with all of those values that we've got out. So first name, last name, and age. So let's look at actually working with that. So we've got some example XML here. We're going to pass that to our transform XML function. And then what that returns essentially is we parse in our payload and then it returns a success of employee Anna Wykes 1. What does that mean? What's the success? So we're working with a try, and a try in Scala will either return us a success or a failure. And what we're doing here is we're saying we're going to have a try of employees. So we're going to attempt to return an employee. So if we get a valid employee, we'll have a success of employee. And that's what this is doing here. But if it fails, it will return a failure. So if any of this fails, it will return a failure, and then we will be able to handle that accordingly. So this is our monad. So this is our steps in our code. So here we've got examples of actually working with it. So if we were then trying to do like a get or else, it would, because that is valid, it returns as an actual employee, else it would return as a value of zero. We can do a map over it and handle the exception accordingly on a recover. So that's how we can work with our actual success and failures. But then we can also work with a match like we saw before and actually do a case of success and a case of failure and then have our code in there and handle it accordingly. But obviously because we have a valid value, it actually returns as an employee, but we will later, we're actually looking at Azure function, look at invalid returned values. Okay, so now we're moving on to our real world example, actually working with the Azure function. So once again, we're going to have our XML, which is read into the Azure function, and then it will output some JSON for us. Okay, so what we've got here is we've got our function in Visual Studio Code. So I've set this up in Visual Studio to demonstrate to you guys. What we've got here is the function itself, which is just boilerplate code. And what we are interested in is this parser.scala. And you will find this very familiar from what we were looking at before in the notebook. We've got our fork comprehension, we're parsing our XML, our first name and last name and age. And then we're yielding that employee, first name, last name, age. And then that will essentially return either, and we're working with either here, not a try, either an error or an employee. So rather than just saying the employee case class as we did before, we're saying actually it could be an error. What's an error? Well, I've defined the error here. That is a case class in itself. And we're just saying we're going to have a reason, and that's going to be a type of string. And then we've just got our boilerplate employee here again with first name, last name, and age. And our parser is just going to handle that accordingly. So I'm going to go into Postman now. So in Postman, if you haven't worked with Postman before, it's a really nice GUI that you can work with to actually work with APIs. So what we want to do, so I'm missing the age attribute there, so we just put that in there. And we do a send. And it returns us our JSON. Now, this URL here, this is an instance of the Azure function we were just looking at in Visual Studio Code that I've actually deployed into Azure. So the exact same code, I've just pushed it out into Azure. And here is our example XML again that we've been working with. We're saying this is our body, this is what we're pushing to the Azure function because it is a HTTP REST endpoint function that we're working with, and then that returns is this JSON response because it's been able to do the transformation, the monad has worked correctly, and it's returned our actual employee object, which is JSON. So what happens if any of these are invalid, if there's anything missing? Well, as you may have, eagle-eyed among you may have seen before, I actually added this back in. If you remove age out, for example, it returns value reason, could not find element, cannot find unique child age. Well, where's it getting that message from? Why is it telling us this? Well, in our code, in these boilerplate functions, what we are doing is, if you look in this find in here, it's doing could not find element, and it's given us the actual message type, so the actual type of the object. So we're able to return this as an error object of it. So we're saying, right, we couldn't actually do the transformation, return an error, and then that bubbles up into our monad, and then that gets returned rather than an employee object returning an error type, and it returns our error message, which we just saw in Postman. Okay, so I've got Azure Storage Explorer open here, and what I'm showing you is an instance of an Azure Data Lake Gen 2 that I've created. And in here, we've got a raw folder and a refine folder. So for those of you who are used to working with data lakes, this is something you'll be very familiar with you. The raw is for your data, that your landing data that you're pulling in, and then your refine is when you take that data and you essentially refine it. So raw data, if we drill down, we can see we've got an employee.json. That employee.json is the exact same data that we've just been working with our Azure function. When we were looking in on Notepad, it's the data that's been transformed from XML into JSON. And I've just written it into this data lake for us to actually do some work with. So that's there in the raw folder, and we want to go and transform it and write it into our refined folder. So what are we going to do now? We are going to go into Databricks again, but this time we are looking at this notebook, which is actually reading from the data lake and actually reading that file, saying this is going to be an instance once again of our case class employee. So we're doing a spark.read, reading our data as an employee, and then that will return us an instance of the case class, of the employee case class, from that JSON data. And for the purposes of this demo, I am illustrating here the data that we are actually going to be comparing it with. Normally this would actually be in the data lake, this would be our historic data that we're comparing it with, but as this is a demo and I want to illustrate what we're doing, I've actually got this hard coded here. So I've got this list of two employees that we're going to compare it to. So what we're going to do is we're going to say, right, I've got this list of existing historic data and I want to filter it based on our new employee that we've actually just received, that new data. And I'm going to filter it based on the ID. So once again, eagle-eyed among you will have noticed we didn't have ID before, but for the purpose of this demo, we have an ID field for our employee. And we're going to do a comparison using a filter. I'm saying, does the ID of our object, of our employee, match the actual employee that we've had come in? And for the purpose of this demo, I'm just working with the first value, but obviously normally you'd have more data in there. Okay, so once we've got this exists, so we've actually done this check with our IDs, we can actually then work with that. So we can say, if it actually exists or if it doesn't. So in this instance, we're saying, is this length is equal to zero? So right, so that employee doesn't actually already exist in our data lake. So we're just going to write that data into our refine folder. So we don't have to do anything with it. We're just going to write it in. But what if we do find a matching record? Well, first things first, we want to actually say, has this data changed? Has anything happened since the last record was written? And so what we can do is we can work with this hash code again that we were looking at before, and actually compare the hash codes of the old and new. And then what this is doing is just comparing and saying, if it finds a match, or if it doesn't find a match in this instance, then we can start actually doing something with the data. So if it finds a match, then essentially do nothing. It's exactly the same. We don't have to write it again. It's already there. Nothing's changed. But if there is no match, this is where we can do our magic. This is where we can put our custom logic in to actually work with the data and do our comparisons. So essentially all we're doing here at the moment is doing a write, and we're overwriting the data again into the refine folder. But essentially, this is where you could do your magic. You can do your custom logic. So running this cell, just wait a moment for it to run. Because I've got a display at the end, this just displays all of the data in your employee there. So we can see that we've got age 21 and a last name Wikes and an ID there as well. So that's displaying as the data, but what we really want to know is, has this actually gone into the data lake? So if we refresh this, we can see now that there are some files in there. So sorry if this isn't very, very clear, but I can assure you that there is a JSON file here that is written, and that is our data being written into JSON from our command in Databricks. So just to confirm what we've done in our session today, we've looked at some basics of Scala, explored what Scala is, who uses Scala, looked at a bit of functional programming, in particular looking at monads, and then we've taken that data and looked at it being used in an Azure function, and once again, that was taken out of a real-world problem, real-world example, old-school XML transforming to JSON. Then we've looked at it in a data lake, looked at how we can work with case classes and transforming it in the data lake. Transforming it in Databricks, sorry, then into the data lake. So hopefully that's been useful. If you have any questions, please give me a shout. But first things first, I've got some useful links here if you're really interested in learning Scala. So I highly recommend Scala exercises, Coursera, looking at some of the Disney blogs, Disney streaming blogs on Medium. They're super useful. And useful conferences, if you're interested in Scala, would be Scala Days, Scala World, Scala Exchange, obviously when conferences are up and running properly again. But there are some really good conferences out there to go to. So yeah, if you want to reach out to me, got any questions, all of the source code will be at that URL, that GitHub repo. I'm available on LinkedIn. I'm available on Twitter. I hope you enjoyed my talk.